Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. In our last few segments, we've been talking about inventory. Specifically, we've been focused on lower of cost or market write-downs. When we think our inventory has dropped in value, what do we have to do to get our books to accurately reflect that our inventory is not what we originally paid for it? Then we wrapped up with a quick discussion of a basket purchase for inventory. Basket purchases for inventory are a little bit different than the basket purchases we've done in the past for, say, PP&E. So we needed to talk about the couple of little tweaks that were part of calculating this value. The next thing we need to talk about is estimating ending inventory. And that's really perhaps the most exciting part of what we get to do in this section. Lower of cost or market, depressing, because it means our inventory has dropped in value. Estimating ending inventory is exciting because it means we don't have to go count inventory, and that's always a neat thing for us in business. Before we jump into methods, let's just take a minute to talk about a couple of conceptual things, one of which is one of our key concepts, and it's this first one. What are the two common reasons for estimating ending inventory? Sometimes we can't do a physical count because a physical count no longer exists. There's been a fire, there's been a flood, there's been an earthquake, there's been a theft, whatever. The inventory is gone. I can't do a count. I have to have methods available to me when I can't do an actual count. The other main reason is because I don't want to do a physical count and pay for the time and the effort that's involved, or because I don't have the ability to do a physical count. I'm an analyst or a vendor. I want to be able to analyze your company, but I can't actually get in there and count your inventory because I'm not part of the company. So because of these reasons, I can use these methods to give us a quick check on inventory and decide if it's accurate or not. And if I am an auditor or I am a manager and I'm looking at the numbers going, what I say on my books is very different from this method. All right, let's do a count. Now, just like there are two reasons to use the methods, there are two methods we can use. The most common is the super shortcut method. That's the gross profit method. The more advanced or involved is the retail inventory method, much more accurate, but much more challenging to deal with as well. Let's start out with this gross profit method. And before we really jump into the method, I have to give you this important warning. You may not use this ending inventory number from the gross profit method in your annual financial statements. FASB will not allow it. You can use them for interim statements, monthly, quarterly, etc. And you can use it for a lot of insurance reports. And it's the FAST method, so a lot of analysts and auditors will use it as well. So it's still very commonly used. And that, again, is one of our key concepts. The fact that even though I can't use it for annual numbers, I can still use it a lot. I just have to be careful not using it in those annual statements. So still a very common, very popular method, just can't use it in this one place. To use the method, you'll need four pieces of information. I need to know the historical cost of beginning inventory. I gotta know net purchases under historical cost. I need to know the amount I sold during the year. And then I need my markup as a percentage of sales. As long as you've got those four pieces of information, then it's a relatively straightforward calculation. In addition to the information that we need, we also have to make a couple of assumptions. And this is where FASB gets a little upset. They don't like these assumptions. First off, we have to assume that beginning inventory plus net purchases gives us total goods to be accounted for. Well, that's the equation FASB gives us for cost of goods available for sale. We're okay with that one. Second, we have to assume that anything not on hand was sold. That one FASB's got a bit of an issue with. What about theft or spoilage? What if things are still in transit? Yeah, I don't know that. I'm making an assumption that if I don't have it on hand, then it must have been sold. And FASB's not as comfortable with that. It's part of the reason why we can't use this for our annual statements. Finally, another equation, total goods to be accounted for minus the sales that we know we've made gives us ending inventory. We're just flipping around that cost of goods sold equation. Normally we take cost of goods available for sale minus ending inventory to get to cost of goods sold. In this case, we're doing it a little bit backward. The other assumption that's not up here, but you probably ought to be comfortable with, we're assuming that this markup is constant. And unless I sell only one product, that's probably not very accurate. There's a lot of different markups that companies use. For example, in the food industry, drinks are typically marked up close to 100%. The food itself is much lower than that. That fourth assumption that we just mentioned and the second one down here are the two reasons why FASB doesn't really care for this method. But we can still use it in a lot of things, so we need to know how. And here are our steps. First, We calculate cost of goods available for sale just as we've done many times in the past. Beginning inventory plus net purchases at cost gives me cost of goods available for sale. Next, I'm going to figure out my sales markup. And sales markup is a little bit different than cost markup. Cost markup means I take my cost plus this given percentage, and that's what I'm going to make my sales price. A sales markup is what I'm making of that profit amount. How much do I keep? Now, the problem that we get to is a lot of companies don't keep a sales markup. They use a cost markup. It comes in at $100. I slap on this percentage, and that's what I mark it up and tell my customers I'm going to charge them. So I have the cost markup instead of the sales markup. But for this method to work, I've got to have the other markup. So we have a simple equation that helps us with this. The sales markup is equal to the cost markup divided by 1 plus the cost markup. So if I know the cost markup comes in, we charge 50% on top of what we paid for it, great. I can take the 50% divided by 1 plus the 50%, and that'll give me my sales markup, and I can go on. Step number 3, once I've got that sales markup, I take sales times the sales markup, and that gives me my gross profit number. And then I can get cost of goods sold as sales minus gross profit. And finally, I can get ending inventory as cost of goods available for sale minus cost of goods sold. Now, if you're like me, that list of steps starts to get kind of confusing towards the end. I'd much rather see it. So now that we've gone through the steps, let's go ahead and jump into an example. SHPW Incorporated lost a bunch of inventory in a recent fire, and they've got to figure out how much was lost so that they can get an insurance payout. Unfortunately, all of their records are gone. Their inventory, of course, is gone. So they contact corporate headquarters, and they started with $1.25 million in inventory in our warehouse. During the period, they purchased $9,565,900 that was shipped to that warehouse. So that's our net purchases for the warehouse. Typical cost markup is 30%. Sales of inventory stored in the warehouse prior to the fire, $11,750,000. And with those four pieces of information, we can do the gross profit method. So let's jump into it. This is my gross profit method. And I'm going to start step 1, beginning inventory at cost plus my net purchases. And please note, it is net purchases, not just gross purchases. So take out your discounts, take out your returns, allowances, etc. Now we were given these numbers. Our beginning inventory was 1.25 million. Our net purchases, 9,565,900. And if I take beginning plus net purchases, I get cost of goods available for sale of $10,815,900. The next piece of this table is to figure out what my cost of goods sold are. But before I can figure out that number, I have to know my sales markup. And I don't know that. What I know instead is the cost markup. So I actually need to jump down to the bottom, and I'm going to do this calculation of my sales markup that we talked about earlier. Remember, we take our cost markup divided by 1 plus the cost markup, and it gives us the sales markup. So in this case, the cost markup was 30%. So 30% divided by 1 plus 30%. If I get rid of the percentages, this becomes 0.3 divided by 1.3. And that gives me about 23%. Now that I know that number, I can come up and finish up my table. This will be step 3. I take my sales number, and that was $11,750,000. And I'm going to subtract my gross profit. Now, I don't know gross profit, but with the sales number and that percentage, I can figure it out. So if I come back down here, I'm going to bring that 11,750 down. If I multiply that by the 23%, my gross profit is $2,702,500. So let me bring that back up here, $2,702,500. I'm going to subtract that. Now let me just stop right here. I have people ask me all the time, hey, can I just multiply the 11.75 million times 1 minus the 23%? If you're comfortable with that, go right ahead. It comes out the exact same way. So feel free to do it that way if that makes more sense to you. Sales minus gross profit gives me cost of goods sold, $9,047,500. And now I'm ready to calculate my ending inventory. If I take my cost of goods available for sale minus my cost of goods sold, then what's left must still be in inventory. And that's my number. Now, some people look at this and it just clicks. Other people look at it and they think, oh, this would be so much better in a T account. I love T account. So let's take just a second and do the T account method. So we started with inventory of 1.25 million. We added 965,900 in purchases. I run through my calculation and I find that I sold this much. So 9,047,500. And if I net that all out, I end up with 1,768,400. So whichever method makes most sense to you, that's great. I strongly recommend that you use it. This is a nice, easy method. It goes right along with what we've done in the past to calculate our cost of goods sold section. And again, fast and easy way to figure out what's in my ending inventory. Now, the other method, which is more accurate but also more involved, is the retail inventory method. We're going to talk about that when we come back. I'll see you then. Thanks.